Hello once again, viewers. Digressive here, and this is the final episode of my playthrough of Mass Effect 1. So let's get a move on, and let's go get to the conduit. So we've just spoken to Vigil, who's filled us in on all the backstory to Mass Effect, the whole lore dump, which is there's just so much to it, and it's such an awesome moment in the game. I really like that whole section with the Vigil. There's an awful lot of talking there, obviously, and loads of dialogue trees and stuff, but what a fantastic part of the game. Whoops, get off the rock. There we go. What a fantastic part of the game. I just love that. That's like when you find out what actually happened to the Protheans and what's going to happen to you if you don't, you know, pull through and all that. I don't know why I'm zooming in there. Having trouble driving the Mako for some reason. Right, there we go. Obviously, we've got some guests to come up here, so this will be as good a time as any to talk about some future updates. Obviously, what I'm going to be doing after Mass Effect 1, now that this is the final part. Obviously, we'll be playing Mass Effect 2 because I love Mass Effect 2 so much. I really do like Mass Effect 1. It is a fantastic game. There's a lot of nostalgia there because it's the beginning of the series and all that. It's not my favourite game in the series. I think 2 is. I think the gameplay is a lot tighter. It's a bit more focused in what it wants to do, even if it's a bit more of a shooter than an RPG, let's be honest, but that's not a criticism at all. It's still got the important parts of the RPG sort of systems in there, for me at least, even though they are cut down. And to be fair, they restored them all in Mass Effect 3 as well, which is probably my second favourite of the series. Unfortunately, Mass Effect 1, I think, for me, is like the last favourite, but I still love the entire series. And Mass Effect 1 obviously introduced the entire series and, you know, started off all the stories and introduced you to all the characters and all that, so it gets props just for being the first. And the game itself is good. I do like it. It's just there were some areas which needed to be polished, and they got polished. They got polished in ME 2 and 3, respectively, so. No, not respectively. That's a completely different thing. I don't know why I just said that. But they got polished. Those elements got polished in ME 2 and 3. Mass Effect 1's just got a great story, and quite a good straightforward story as well. I kind of like the simplicity of just what you've got to do. The fact that you're just in it, you know. There's a lot going on around you, but you are just in it, and you're having an adventure. You're just going from one end of the galaxy to the other, just trying to figure out what the hell's going on. And I like that. You're not the shepherd yet, so to speak. You know what I mean? You're not the hero that is shepherd. ME 2 and 3 are the shepherd. You know. That's when you're a superhero. But yeah, I guess I like that about anyone. I suppose it's got a quaintness to it. That sounds really bad, but it does. It does have that sort of quaintness to it. But yeah, so updates wise, yes, Mass Effect 2 will be coming after this. I'll probably have a bit of a break after playing this, because obviously I recorded these somewhat in advance. You probably figured that out already. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to get them out on time all the time with the day job and so on. But I do record a little bit in advance, so I'm going to probably have a little bit of a break from playing Mass Effect and play some other things, and then we'll start off with ME2, and yeah, we'll just get into ME2. And I'm really looking forward to ME2. I'm looking forward to playing a Sentinel in ME2. I'm looking forward to being a bit of a Paragade and choosing both sides and all that sort of stuff. Really looking forward to that. So we've got an awesome little space battle cutscene here, which I love the way they all come out of the Mass Effect sort of the Mass Effect. I love how Sovereign comes out of it, and it's just ginormous as well. It's just badass, really, really badass. So Mass Effect 2, playing a Sentinel, that means I get tech armor, and I can't wait for tech armor because I love tech armor. I really do. I think Sentinel was the second class that I ever played after a Soldier. I believe, and I'm not certain, but I believe, yeah, I think it was. I think it was the second game I ever had of Mass Effect was as a Sentinel. And I just thought tech armor was so cool. This is Mass Effect 2, of course. I think it was one of my imports. I decided to change the class to a Sentinel, and I just love that tech armor, dude. It looks awesome. Looks amazing. And I can't wait to see what it all looks like on PC as well. That should be really cool. So, yeah, Mass Effect 2. coming out. Installers near you. So that'll be a fun game to play through as well. I suppose my only regret with Mass Effect 1 is, like this playthrough, is that this is the first time I've sort of done a Let's Play of this magnitude, this length. It's one of my first Let's Plays, sort of entire, I think. Especially with this type of game, and it's quite open world, there's lots to do and all that, so I'm kind of proud that I managed to do it at all, in a way. And I think I've got an awful lot of fixes to sort of implement in the playthrough that I do of Mass Effect 2. A lot of little things I'm going to work on, I'm going to try out, and hopefully they'll help with the editing and sort of production and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, we'll see how that goes. Because of course, the biggest enemy of doing gameplay videos on YouTube is the music, especially with Mass Effect, because the music's just so copyrighted. It's just everywhere. And the music in Mass Effect is great. It's part of the experience as far as I'm concerned, but I can't leave it in there and not get copyright flagged all the time. So I guess that will just have to be... It'll just have to be something I deal with, and unfortunately there won't be the music in my playthroughs. You probably noticed that in certain areas of this playthrough, in certain episodes, the sort of audio has been reduced to silence. That's why. I may have explained it before, I don't remember explaining it in this sort of amount of details. here I go. That's what it was. It was because of those sorts of things. So I've basically reduce the audio so you can't hear anything, and that's just down to how I record things as well, which means that my commentary hasn't come over. So I'm going to be changing that up hopefully, and then I'll still be able to comment over things, and the audio might go completely, so it doesn't get picked up by a copyright. Because sometimes obviously I'll take a break, I'll breathe, or have a sip of my drink to quench my thirst and all that, and as that's going, then a bit of music gets through, and it gets flagged by copyright flagged on YouTube. So hopefully that won't happen in future, because I'll record my commentary separately. So, but anyway, this wasn't really meant to be an inside baseball sort of chat about how I make these Let's Plays. I was supposed to be talking about Mass Effect and how I'm going to make ME2 better, the Let's Play of ME2 better, and ME3 as well, and all the other Let's Plays that I do, because I will do other games, other Let's Plays of other games as well at some point, and get back to doing reviews and all that sort of thing as well, so I'll do that, but I'll save that for a different video, and that information for hopefully a channel update video or something like that. I'll figure out some way of doing it at some point. Obviously, hopefully by then I'll have some more subscribers, and it'll be even more worth it. And by the way, if you're watching this video and you're a new subscriber, thanks very much. If you're watching this video and you're not a new subscriber, please feel free to subscribe if you like what you're seeing, and that would be great. Stick around, there's plenty more to come. I've got plans, schemes and plans of more games to play and all that sort of thing. I like many, many different sorts of games, not just Mass Effect, not just RPGs, so I will definitely be playing some shooters and different sorts of games. So hopefully at some point there'll be something that you like. Just in case Mass Effect isn't your thing, because it's not for everyone. RPGs and sci-fi and all that, not for everyone, so it does make sense to... that, you know, if you don't follow this playthrough, then obviously that makes sense. But of course, if you're not following this playthrough, you're probably not listening to me talking right now. So there we go. There's another awesome space battle cutscene here, which, man, I really do like. Mass Effect does them so well. Although I've noticed, and maybe it's just me, that these all look like they're rendered in-game, or sort of in-game. They're not incredible CGI, put it that way. Even if they're not in-game, they might be CGI, but they're not sort of super high-quality CGI. Whereas you see Mass Effect 2s and 3s, and they definitely are, man. They're definitely much better quality CGI. But I guess, you know, they got a high budget. Or maybe it's just the time moving on and technology getting better, you know. I don't know. Still awesome cutscenes though. Can't deny that. this bit was so badass when you figure out that you're basically going to get out and walk on the side of the citadel. Or rather on the inside, on the Presidium Tower of the Citadel, and just run up it. It's just, yeah, that was just badass. Alright, let's do this thing, man. And of course you see Sovereign in the background. It should be there somewhere. There it is, banging on the hull. And that's just badass as well. I mean, running right up into it as well, you know. Right up underneath it. Just to show you how big it is. Yeah, fantastic. Fantastic stuff. So yeah, now that we're at the end of Mass Effect, or Mass Effect 1 rather, it's probably about time to talk about what I would like to see in Mass Effect, well, in the future of Mass Effect, like Mass Effect 4 or whatever they end up calling it, just while we're going through all this combat, because this combat is fairly easy, more or less. I bet you anything I died during this combat now, just because I've said that. Yeah, Mass Effect 4, or again, whatever they end up calling it. I'm dead set on them doing something in the future. I don't need to see anything from the past. It's got to involve humans in some small way, because otherwise it's going to be hard to relate to. You know, even though we love the Asari and the... what are the other races? Krogan and Geth and Tali's race, what they call it, Quarians, all that sort of stuff, you know? Of course, we love all those things, but you've got to have humans involved in some ways, just to make it a little bit more relatable for people. Just in case you're not already a Mass Effect fan, you know, because those people do exist. Wow, this is all getting a little bit too close to the comfort, isn't it? There we go. We're good. We're good. We're good. Yeah, we're good. Okay. So yeah. Me personally, I'm dead set on them doing something in the future. I want something in the future. I don't necessarily want to see the First Contact War or anything like that again, because they've covered them in the comic books, as far as I'm aware, and some of it in the novels. Not much, but most of it's. I'm pretty sure most of it's been in the comic books. And then there's Foundations, which I hear is going down a storm. I've not heard great things about it. I mean, I've heard good things about the writing, like the writing's okay, but not so much some of the artwork and things like that, and how some of the story contradicts events that have already been told in the games and stuff, but I don't know, I haven't read it, so, or read them rather, so I don't know. I like the novels written by Drew Karpyshyn, so I usually, I've only read them, I've not read any of the other stuff really. Did Mac Walters write a book? I can't remember if Mac Walters wrote a book. Never mind, but I've not read many of the comic books. The few bits I have seen, I generally quite like. I've seen some of the stuff that you get in the collector's editions of Mass Effect and things like that. That's all good, I like that stuff. It's fun. I mean, they're graphic novels. They're not novels. They're comic books. And that's not being, I'm not, you know, saying comic books aren't. Can't have complex stories or anything. I'm just saying that those comic books are pretty good and I like them, but I just really enjoyed the novels just so much better, just because of the denseness. It seemed very, very detailed and dense. And I like that. I mean, to be fair, I didn't read the novels. I had them on Audible. You know, the speaking books. So, I experienced them that way, and part of that experience is the reader as well, and the reader that they got to do the Mass Effect novels was fantastic, in my opinion. I think it was great. So, those novels, Drew Karpyshyn's writing, paired with the readers, absolutely fantastic. Really enjoyed those novels. Anyway, so, Mass Effect 4, the future of Mass Effect, that's what we're talking about. Yeah, I'm dead. Like I say, I'm dead set on them doing something in the future. I want to know what they, because of course it will be after Mass Effect 3 if they did that. I want to know what ends up becoming of the Citadel and the Keepers. And now that we know so much about it, which I assume we would know a lot more about it if it was going to be in the future, we would have found out its secrets and all that sort of thing, so to speak. So I would really want to know more about the Citadel, because they could tell us more about that, and more about the Reapers, because they're not a threat anymore, so to speak, as far as we know. And he's dead, cool. I just want to know more about that, and then I get there would obviously have to be some sort of threat, so they'd have to be a new threat or something. I don't know, I've not thought that out. I'm not sure what they could do. The only things I thought that they could do would just basically turn it into a bit of a generic sci-fi thing, which has already been done. And what I like about Mass Effect is it's an amalgamation of a lot of other sci-fis, true, but it does have some obviously original qualities to it, which is what makes it fantastic. What I like about it, anyway. So yeah, I'm like I say, that's about as far as I've got. If you ask me what I want from Mass Effect, there's a couple of things which I would say you're going to have that, because that's what makes Mass Effect Mass Effect. Biotics, for example. Yes, it's basically the Force from Star Wars, but Biotics is the Mass Effect version of that. And they would have to do that, because that's Mass Effect, you know? As far as I'm concerned, anyway. Space travel, obviously, the mass relays. This is why everyone got so bent out of shape about the ending, is when you destroy the mass relays, that's part of the Mass Effect universe. You can't get rid of that, you know? You cannot get rid of that. That's like saying Star Trek. I was going to say Star Trek without the Enterprise, but that doesn't make any sense, because there has been Dead Space. Deep Space Nine and Voyager, and they didn't have Enterprise, but you know, Star Trek without the Federation, I guess? Star Trek without the Federation, because the Federation's always been in Star Trek. That's probably a bit of a bad example. But you know what I mean, it's the Mass Effect relays are part of the Mass Effect lore, that's how they get around the galaxy. And although you could replace it with something else, it doesn't seem right. Like, that's an iconic piece of the Mass Effect universe at this point, you know? They've existed forever, so they've existed forever. So how can you get rid of them? It doesn't make any sense. Ah, there we go. That was getting close for comfort again, wasn't it? I saw that biotic thing go right past me there. But this is getting tough. This is getting a little bit mental. Okay, there we go. I think we're pretty much done there. Yeah. Right, sorry guys, that was getting crazy there for a second. Alright. So let's go all the way back down here. Yeah, so we talked about the Mass Effect relays and how they're sort of ingrained in the Mass Effect universe and sort of almost make it what it is. And you could say the Normandy does, but the Normandy's, you know, they've already said that they don't want to do anything to do with Shepard, which makes sense. I'm not sure if that's going to resonate with people. I mean, I like the universe, I like the characters, but again, they don't want to do anything to do with Shepard or the characters, so that just leaves the universe. And I think again, the novels did it pretty well, but they were to do with Anderson, which is granted only tangentially related to Shepard, and Kaylee Sanders, who isn't related at all to her until ME3, because she pops up in ME3, which is brilliant. I was loving that. That was fantastic. It was great to see some characters from the novels in the game. Just awesome. It was interesting to see Kai Lang, but unfortunately, personally, and this is I suppose where how people feel when their favorite novel gets made into a movie. I felt like Kai Lang was completely different from how he appeared in the game. Like, the impression I got from the book was much, much different. But, hey, that's that, I guess. So, we got the final confrontation with Saren. Here we go. So, I suppose, just while this cutscene's going on, long story short, that's really all I want from the future of Mass Effect is, I mean, BioWare can do whatever they want, obviously, you know. But I really think it's got to be in the future. They've got to move forward with these things. You can't keep on going back and doing prequels, as Star Wars has learned. I don't think that's going to work. And, you know, Star Trek tried it out, and we all saw how that went. That was Enterprise. I don't think Enterprise worked in a... I don't think Enterprise worked as a prequel. I mean, I enjoyed Enterprise when it got going. The first season was terrible, but Enterprise was okay.
In a few minutes, Sovereign will have full control of all the Citadel systems. The relay will open, the Reapers will return.
But, yes, I'm looking forward to seeing what's coming for the Mass Effect universe in future. I am still a really, really big fan, and I'm excited to see what's going to happen, you know? But we'll just have to play the waiting game until then. Before that, we've got Dragon Age Inquisition, of course. I'm sure that's looking fantastic, so I'm excited. I'm getting into the Dragon Age universe. That's not traditionally my sort of... My deal. I don't do that sort of thing, but I've started playing Dragon Age Origins and I'm enjoying it a lot. I'm really getting into that, really getting into the universe, and especially the characters. The characters were amazing in that. I would even go so far as to say it's slightly better than some of the companions in Mass Effect. I don't know, ME2 maybe not, but ME1, they were a little bit flat in ME1. Mainly because, you know, it's the first game, they're not properly fleshed out yet. I think all the companions got really properly fleshed out in ME 2 and 3. Again, by the end of ME 3, those companions are, you know, good friends by the end of the game. But Dragon Age Origins, man, I'm really enjoying the companions I've got so far. Alistair's hilarious, and Morrigan's brilliant, and I forget the other girl's name, Leliana or something like that. I really like her, she's great, she's fantastic. Yeah, and of course the dog. You get your dog. There's not one I don't like yet.
We can't stop it. Not forever. You saw the visions. You saw what happened to the Protheans. The Reapers are too powerful.
You could have resisted. You could have fought. Ah, now she's getting pissed off because I'm going renegade. I love how Saren, how this goes on with Saren. This is just awesome. Just awesome.
I'm sorry. It is too late for me.
There's still one way to stop this, if you've got the guts.
Goodbye, Shepard. Thank you.
Ah, it's awesome. What a great way to talk your nemesis into killing himself. I mean, granted, we've still got a boss battle to come up, but there's you. If you can't do that, I know you have to have another boss battle with him, which is similar to the one that happens on Vermeier. Renegade plus 25. I am a. Let's just have a look quickly. Yeah, I am a Paragade. I had full Paragade option anyway, so there you go. There's my Intimidate. There's no point in me putting any points in that right now, so. In fact, there's not much point in putting any points in anything right now, so I'll leave that until I do a new game plus or something, I think. Right, let's go open up the Citadel Arms and let the good guys in. Let Joker in and all the rest. Save the Council. Yes, that's the decision I'm making. We're saving the Council. That's what we're doing.
Quick, open the station's arms. Maybe the fleet can take Sovereign down.
See if you can open a communications channel.
Drives offline. Kinetic barriers down 40%. The Council is on board. I repeat, the Council is on board.
Normandy to the Citadel. Normandy to the Citadel. Please tell me that's you, Commander.
It certainly is me, Joker.
We caught that distress call, Commander. I'm sitting here in the Andura sector with the entire Arcturus fleet. We can save the Ascension. Just unlock the relays around the Citadel, we'll send the cavalry in.
You'd sacrifice human lives to save the Council?
I know, but most people either sacrifice the Council or at least do the middle option. Every organic species in the galaxy. Or at least it seems that way to me. Most people seem to do that. But and it makes sense. In a lot of the ways, it does make sense to sacrifice the Council or at least say, try to save the Council, but they end up dying anyway. But I gotta do the good thing, the right thing, you know? It just makes more sense to me. Even though that's the correct choices, and you know, save your ships for the Sovereign, because that's a real threat. But let's save the Council anyway.
Now, Joker. We need to save the Ascension, no matter what the cost.
That's what my shepherds like, man.
The Council appreciates this.
Well, they won't, not until ME3. But then they'll really appreciate it. Then in ME3, they will really appreciate it, because then the Reapers will start coming down, and you know. And they really start kicking the crap out of everyone's planets, and then they still don't help. And even then, the Council still go, sorry, we still can't help. I love the way Joker even, you know, mentions that in ME3. It's just, well, no spoilers for ME3, I guess, but hey, there we go. never mind, eh? Minor spoilers. It's not like I've just given away the end of the game or anything. And to be fair, if you're watching this, then you've probably played the games in one way or another anyway. But just in case I haven't, no real spoilers. I'm definitely going to keep spoilers to a minimum. I know I've already spoiled a few things in this game, but in this playthrough. But nothing too bad, nothing too major, I don't think. I think I've managed to keep most of the big things to myself. But ME2 and my Let's Play of that, I will definitely keep spoilers to a absolute minimum. To be honest with you, I started this playthrough and I didn't quite know what I was going to do with things and how I was going to handle things. But now I've got a pretty good idea of how to handle things. So yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. So spoilers will get to a minimum. Obviously, I've got a few things which I'm gonna tweak here and there, and hopefully make for better episodes. I don't know. I suppose I should ask you about this last one. Let me know in the comments or anything what you think. But I was thinking. Usually I play like a few hours of a game, so this is why some episodes have an intro and an outro, or an intro. Or an outro, and sometimes not both, and sometimes they do, because generally I play like a whole rack of missions, or you know, a good few hours of the game, and start with an intro, and then I play for however long I play for, and then do an outro. And I don't realize the time, and I don't realize it's been over half an hour or whatever. I like keeping my episodes down to about half an hour. It seems to be about right. For most things in the game. So usually I try to do that, but of course, when you're editing, it doesn't always end up that way. So I don't know whether you guys need or like an intro and outro, whether you just like me to get straight into it sometimes and just carry on, because I like doing that. That's in some ways it gives like a. In some ways it's inconsistent, which is not great for a show. In some ways. Nah, I can't use my powers. And I'm overheating. There we go. Now we're back to normal. Use those powers, come on. He's gone up there. I guess he was stasis there for a second. We got stasis? No. Right, use that and that. There we go. We should get our little cutscene in no time at all. There you go. Health's coming down. Nice one. There we go. Here's our cutscene. So, I guess in some ways you guys would want a intro outro sort of thing, so if that's what you want, let me know in the comments, say yes to intro outro, and if you're not bothered at all, if you're perfectly happy with me just carrying right along with multiple episodes, sometimes having intros and sometimes not having outros and so on and so forth, you know what I mean, just let me know which one you would prefer, because I'm okay either way, I am alright either way. Just let me know what you want. It just occurred to me the other day, actually, that I very rarely ever ask the audience. Granted, that right now, it's a small audience, but hopefully it'll grow soon. I just realized that I don't really ask much of you guys, and that's usually to do with how I sort of film these episodes and the fact that I film like a whole batch together and then upload them and sort of release them timed. But I'm going to try and do that a bit more, sort of ask your involvement in creating the channel and what you guys want to see and how you guys want me to sort of tackle things. You know, it'll be good for me, it'll be good for you, because that's what you guys want, and I'm more than happy to create content that you guys want to watch. That is the business that I'm in. I'm okay picking out games as long as you let me know what you want to see, or if there's something particular that you want to see. Like, I cut out Pinnacle Station this because it's basically a big grind fest, and I want to do it to level up and get the XP, but there was no real point in me. What am I trying to say? I guess there's no real point in me videoing all that and trying to find enough stuff to talk about, because that's a long piece of content, and it's extremely grindy, and I don't know if I could have found find anything to talk about for that length of time. but some of you guys might want to see like maybe a time lapse of it, or just want to see little bits of it, just to know that I did it, I guess. By the way, I definitely did it. I remember, but of course you guys didn't see that. I didn't show you anything to do with that content. It's in the quest list. I've probably scrolled past it a billion times when we were doing the UNC missions, but you guys never. I never asked you guys whether you wanted to see that or not. So I guess in future we'll try to be a bit more on top of that and try and get you a bit more involved in the channel, because I'm more than happy to talk with you guys and all that. And like I said, more than happy to create content that you guys want to see. Or if there's just one little thing that's bugging you, could you change this? We'll definitely work on that, you know. If it's possible, if I can change it, then yeah, I'll totally do it. If not, I'll try to give you a decent reason why it's not possible. Or at the very least, I'll try to explain why I don't think it's possible. But either way, we can have a conversation about it. Now, this really is one of the best endings to a game, and just such a heroic feeling, such a good feeling about this. I love it. Just love it. And this is like the whole point where you're like, oh man, is Shepard dead, you know? I mean, they could have killed you at the end of ME1, so in ME2 you just import your choices and you're a completely different character, like how Dragon Age goes, you know. In Dragon Age you're a different character each time. But nah, this is going to be Shepard's alive, and it's that sort of ending. But it's just so cool to sort of see your Shepard rise from the rubble with nothing more than maybe a few broken bones here and there. And just, you know, fucking heroic. Just love it. Just love it. Badass. Oh man, I love that. Just love it. Can't go on enough about that.
Commander Shepard, we have gathered here to recognize the enormous contributions of the Alliance forces in the war against Sovereign and the Geth.
Many humans lost their lives in the battle to save the Citadel. Brave and courageous soldiers who willingly gave their lives so that we, the Council, might live.
There is no greater sacrifice, and we share your grief over the tragic loss of so many noble men and women.
The Council also owes you a great personal debt, Commander, one we can never repay.
Because we saved your ass.
Our lives, but the lives of billions from Sovereign and the Reapers.
Commander Shepard, your heroic and selfless actions...
Just such a good ending as well. Very, very up. Very hopeful. Very, sort of your work here is done, sort of thing, to an extent. Like, there's more work to come, but you've won this round sort of thing. That's a good feeling. I remember the first time completing this and just the feeling it gave me is just so cool. So cool. Really enjoyed it.
Counselor, on behalf of humanity and the Alliance, we thank you for this prestigious honor and humbly accept.
We will need a list of potential candidates to fill humanity's seat on the council.
All right, now, even though this choice does not make any change to ME1 whatsoever, other than this final sort of line and ending here, because in ME2 it doesn't import, because the save has already happened. It's already saved, and that's the save that you import. All this stuff doesn't get saved from here on out. Little fun fact for you there, just in case you didn't know how Mass Effect fucking does its dodgy save system. Anyway, I'm going to pick Anderson because I love Keith David. He's a fantastic voice actor, and he does this line better than anyone. Udina's fine, but he's going to get in power anyway, so
we need someone
here we go.
With
Let's
the courage
do Captain
to stand
Anderson.
Up for what he believes in. Someone like Captain Anderson.
Because he's a badass.
You must be joking. Anderson prefers to let his fists do the talking.
Only with you, Ambassador. Only with you.
Are you sure about this, Commander? The captain's a soldier, not a politician.
Well, that's why we're picking him.
We've already got too many politicians on the Citadel. The captain would be perfect for this job. I think it's an inspired choice. The Council would welcome him with open arms, should he accept.
I'm honored, Counselor. As humanity's representative, I'll do everything in my power to help the Council rebuild.
Sovereign's defeat marks the beginning of a new era for both humanity and the Council.
This isn't over yet. And they're all pretty badass, let's be honest, but I'm going to go, this isn't over yet. And then the Mass Effect theme starts kicking in there as Shepard gives her sort of final lines.
And I'm going to find some way to stop them.
Yeah, just walks off into the sunset, so to speak.
Shepherd's
awesome.
Right.
Just awesome.
Humanity is ready to do its part.
And then, like, Anderson's final line. This is awesome, man. This is so badass.
When the Reapers come, we must stand side by side. We must fight against them as one. And together, we will drive them back into dark space.
Yeah. It's just... Oh, man. Just so badass. And then you get this final shot. This is the Paragon version. The Renegade version. It's all red, and there's a big red planet in the background, and she's got a gun, and she cocks the rifle on it. It's a Renegade. And that final image there is real cool. Love that. And it's your Shepard as well. It's not some, you know, sort of stock footage or whatever. It's actually your Shepard, man. And then you get the Normandy flying off into the sunset, and... Yeah, and then the final credit song as well, which is just unexpectedly, again, so cool. Just so badass. So guys, this is the end of my Mass Effect playthrough, and this is the final part. So thanks very much for watching, and please like, comment, and subscribe. I haven't said that in actually any of the episodes yet, so yeah, please do that. Please let me know what you think of it, and if you think there's anything I can sort of fix, or any problems you had with it. I've sort of been... This has been a learning experience for me. I've definitely altered some things and changed some things as we've been going, but I'm definitely going to be making some bigger changes when it comes to doing Mass Effect 2, and some just little tweaks to make it a little bit easier to deal with, and edit and all that sort of stuff. So. Anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.